Thanks for downloading Pave the Way Podcast. On this show, your host, Greg Helbeck, interviews the top minds in real estate, business, and personal development to help you crack the code so you can grow your business and, more importantly, grow your life. Get ready for another game-changing episode. If you want to learn how to master your day and become a productivity monster, download Greg's free guide on daily personal productivity for free at www.pavetheday.com. That's Pave the Day, spelled D-A-Y.com. Now it's time for today's episode. Enjoy.
All right, everyone. Welcome back to the show. Greg Helbeck here with my accountant, Andrew Kabatchnick. How you doing, Andrew? I think this is the third time you've been on the show, so I'm looking forward to this one.
I think it's the third or fourth, at least the third, that's for sure. And I'm doing pretty good. How about you?
I'm doing awesome, man. I think last time we had a show, it was way before the COVID pandemic. So how did all that impact you and your business? I know you actually acquired a guy's CPA firm or something. So you've obviously been getting a lot busier.
So I ended up working with that when we were talking last time, and that actually went south a little bit.
Oh,
and
boy.
Thankfully, I found out quickly and we were able to kind of break apart pretty easily. So it wasn't as bad as it could have been. But look, no, it's okay. I'm still on the hunt. Business is good. Business is thankfully, at least during tax time, busier than ever.
Oh yeah.
And here we are trying to help people pay the least amount possible and figure out how to get all structured and everything. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
That's the theme of our show today. By the way, quick question for you. I mean, when it comes to like, what did you see? Like I didn't do any of like the PPP stuff last year. I just didn't need to. I'm not like flexing, but like, I just didn't need to do that. Like my business was fine. But what did you see across the board with a lot of people that you work with? Like, how did that all kind of like come into fruition? Cause also like the taxes got arrears and like, it just was weird, man. I had all this money in a bank account. I'm like, when am I going to pay these taxes so I could just get rid of this? Like, how did all that, you know, for you as an accountant, you know?
So the last 2 years, so COVID really hit, I guess it was like mid end of March of 2020, right?
Yeah, and that's when it started getting weird for sure.
Yeah, and it was a mess, really. Tax season was a mess. We got extended till July 15th. There were so many moving parts with all of the payments and the stimulus and the loans and the PPP. And then we thought it was dying down and they got more stimulus in there. And this past tax season was a mess again. We got extended only 1 month until May, but it was messy, and it's probably not going to get totally better until next year, I think, because now they're advancing some credits, some child tax credits, stuff like that. The IRS, and you can't really blame them too much. They're understaffed, and a lot of people are still home, but they have like 20 or 30 million unprocessed e-filed returns, electronic returns, like 30 million unprocessed. And that's not even including the truckloads of paper filed returns, mail from notices. People get notices, just random different things, answers to the notices. And then, so after they handle all of this stuff and process it, there's going to be more like notices for this year's returns and misguided and misput in stimulus amounts. And it's coming. It's going to be a mess for a little bit longer, I think. Let's put it.
Yeah, what do they say? It's going to get worse before it gets better, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
We're not looking forward to 2022 tax season too much either. It's going to be.
Well, is that going to be in April now, or is that going to get like back on track, or is it still going to be pushed out, you think?
Who knows? Yeah. Who knows? My gut feeling is they'll probably have to push back a little bit again, just because there's so many moving parts. That being said, we're hoping the moving parts are done, so maybe it won't be so bad. I don't know. It's hard to tell.
Well, it'll be interesting for sure. So that's good to hear. I mean, obviously the biggest thing, well, with accountants, I mean, crap, everyone's going to have to do their taxes, no matter who you are, no matter how much money you made or didn't make, you got to do your taxes somewhat, some way. So the I think the theme of the show, I mean, a couple of years ago, you introduced me to the whole idea of having the LLC be structured as an S corp to save on taxes. And I remember I was reluctant at first. I'm like, I don't know about this. I don't know, you know, and you know, it ended up making me a lot of extra money because I was able to, you know, strategically pay less taxes. So I want you, I'm not the expert there. So I want you to kind of elaborate on why that benefits people, maybe what an LLC is, what an S corp is, if someone's brand freaking new, and then we'll just kind of get right into it.
So an LLC and S corps on the surface, you have to remember our legal structures first, right? So the legal importance of some sort of structure, especially in the real estate game, is you're trying to protect your assets if something were to go wrong in one of your deals, right? Let's say something, let's say something goes wrong in one of your wholesale deals, or let's say you have a rental and you don't get to plowing the snow quick enough, somebody slips and falls, gets hurt, anything that could bring about legal liability. You're hoping to have these structures to protect your other assets against potential lawsuits. And yes, there's insurance, which you should also have. Make sure you're properly insured on all of your properties, depending upon what you're doing with it. But that being said, the structures are important. Then the secondary importance is there's different tax planning with different structures, right? So for example, if you have a rental, you have it protected, it's almost never a good idea to put the rental itself in an S corp, right? Rentals should almost always, if not always, stay out of S corps for tax purposes, because if you start retitling the properties, you could easily run into tax issues with the gains on the property. Even though you still might be the owner of the property, it's not a good idea to put it in an S corp. Have it in an LLC. Some people argue to put it in trusts, which is a more complicated legal structure. Fine, but probably not a good idea to put it in an S corp. The S corps, go ahead.
No, I was going to say that. That's interesting. Just keep going. I like this.
The S corps are more tax advantageous for active businesses, wholesaling. Let's say you're a construction guy who does rehabbing, an accountant, a doctor, anything that's active, and you would be charged, potentially charged, the self-employment taxes that you discussed, the Social Security and the Medicare, and there could be some savings there if you're paying yourself a proper salary and then distributing the rest as a quote-unquote distribution or dividend where there would be none of this tax on it. There would be there's income tax on your full profit, but not the self-employment taxes like you would have just in a plain LLC.
So let me just try to repeat that back to you. So I'm on the same page and the listeners are on the same page. So let's say someone's making $800,000 a year flipping houses. I mean, that's, you know, you could do that. It's not abnormal to do that. And they're paying themselves a reasonable salary, right? Let's say whatever. Instead of having to go out and pay taxes on all their distributions, they're paying taxes on their salary. And then the business is going to pay taxes on whatever the profit would be, right? But then, so you're kind of skirting around. Is that what you kind of said, or did I screw that up?
No, you're pretty close. You're pretty close.
Okay.
So the business profit flows through, so you're paying personal for the most part anyway.
Yeah.
Just on everything other than the salary, you're not paying the Medicare and Social Security.
Yes, that's what you're not paying.
That could be up till about 15%. right? So let's say you're netting that 800K on your wholesaling, right?
Yeah.
And you come to your account and you say, what do I do? I just made 800,000. What do I do?
Yeah.
So then we're going to say, okay, you got to pay yourself a reasonable salary, which if you're making 800K in flipping, it's not going to be zero. It might be 100K.
Yeah.
125K or something like that. But then you're saving at least a couple percent on the other 700,000. You're saving 15.3 up to the Medicare cap, which is like 130,000. And then a couple percent of Medicare tax on top of that. So on 600,000-700,000, you could be saving 2%.
That's a lot of money.
That's 12 or 15K right there.
Yeah.
Just on the 2%. If your salary is reasonable, you're good. And that's money that could be going into another deal.
Yeah. Or marketing or whatever.
Yeah. Anything. Yeah, you're right. Anything.
That's interesting. And that's stuff. That's why I like bringing you on the show, because a lot of people, they just kind of go by the seat of their pants and then they get a tax bill and they're like, holy crap. Like, what am I going to do? And a lot of them don't, like, there's a great book I love called Profit First. And I actually take every deal I do, I take a chunk of that money and I put it in a bank account for my taxes. So I don't have to worry about it at the end of the year. And, you know, some people don't do that. They get in trouble. They're like, they spent that money and then they owe 50 grand to the IRS. And they're like, oh my God, I don't have this money. And they got to earn the money. They get taxed and then pay the back tax. And they're in this like downward spiral, you know?
Yeah. It could get ugly really quick. If you're netting that 700-800K and you're irresponsible with the money that should have been left aside for your taxes.
Yeah, for sure. And here's another question I have for you now. Now, you know, you're based in the New York area. You know, I live in New York, California, mostly California and New York. So when it comes to living, like living in a state where you do bit, like, what is the, like, what are some, besides California, like, what other states are pretty, because a lot of people preach Florida and Texas. I really wouldn't want to live there personally. I just don't really think they're great areas to live in full time.
Yeah.
So like, if someone lives in California, are they really paying that much more in taxes than someone in New York, or is it pretty much the same thing? Because like I'd rather live in a nice area like California or New York and like just pay the taxes because I like it, you know?
Yeah. So it depends where you're doing business. So most people, like I live in New York and I'm doing business in New York and New Jersey.
Yeah.
Your business we have structured in New York, because California really is worse. California is a nice area, but they're not forgiving on their taxes. It's very expensive. All LLCs and corps have an $800 minimum tax, no matter how much. You could be making $1 and the minimum tax for the corp in California is $800.
Just to have a corporation every year.
Yep. Or an LLC, anything.
Interesting.
So New York is better, I think. New Jersey is better, I think. But they're not the best tax-wise either. It's still expensive. It's still tax-heavy to live in these states.
Yeah, it is very tax-heavy.
Yeah. So people are right. Texas, Nevada, Florida are better. There's some middle of the road type states that are like Tennessee and Georgia and the Carolinas are better. They're not Florida, but they're better than New York and California.
What about Connecticut? Is that a bad tax state?
So Connecticut is better than New York.
Is it?
By a little bit.
Interesting.
The property taxes are lower. I think we get more services in New York.
You do. The quality of life is better in the more in like the Californians and the New Yorks. People don't talk about that.
Yeah. You know? Like, for example, my wife is an occupational therapist in a school and my mother-in-law is one too. And I think we have better services overall in New York than they do in Connecticut.
Yeah.
But we're paying for it.
Yeah.
It's not free. That's for sure.
Oh, for sure. It's not free. That's interesting. Here's another question that a lot of people, and this is something, this pertains to flipping houses, not wholesaling. When you're wholesaling, you're just pretty much making a spread on like the buy and the sell. There's not a lot of cost of goods sold involved. So I found this out not that long ago. When you're basically a flipper of homes and you're taking title and you're reselling and doing that type of business, the homes that you own while they're in progress are inventory. So you're basically like a dealer of houses. So like your products and your inventory are your homes. So when you're selling, so let me just give you an example, because this will make more sense.
Yep.
Let's say someone flips 45 homes that year. Okay.
Yep.
They buy the homes, they fix them up, or they just don't even fix them up. They just buy and sell the homes and they take title for a while, like at least a month.
Yeah.
Now, would you, from a tax perspective, from a liability, like from a gains perspective,
yeah,
if their business is like 123 home flipping company,
yeah,
would you look at a P&L on every single property and individualize that? So like one property was bought for 350 and they put 400, they put 100 into it and they sold it for 650. So then the sales is 650. Or would you just look at it from like the profit on the home after everything is said and done was $75,000? Would you record the 75,000 as revenue, or would you record the 600 and whatever thousand as revenue? And then you back out the cost of goods. Cause like, that's where it like people like get really confused and like, you know, it's a big deal.
It really kind of depends a little bit, right? So a lot of times if you're taking, if you're wholesaling a property, you're not really taking title for long. So you're not getting any reporting other than your own internal reporting. Of your P&L and your expenses, the whole bit.
Yeah.
If you take title to a property and let's say you're flipping it, and even if it's just a quick lipstick deal and you're selling it in 4-6 weeks or something like that, right? You're still potentially getting some government reporting documents for that. And it would be a 1099-S to either you or your LLC. So if that's the case, then you have to really report the full sale price and then back out the purchase, the flip, the construction costs and all of that.
Yeah.
So it really kind of depends on the situation. And it's a good that you brought this up, because a lot of people think that when you wholesale or flip a house that it might be capital gains. It's generally not capital gains. It's generally ordinary income.
Interesting. And
there's a difference there. In ordinary income is usually high, a little bit higher tax rates, and which can include that Social Security and Medicare, right? So think about it like this. I know it's a little bit different, but I couldn't claim that my accounting fees are capital gains, right?
No, it's ordinary income.
Right. So it's the same when you're flipping houses. And I know sometimes the sale of a house could be capital gains, but that's more if you're selling a rental or selling your personal residence, usually where capital gains are involved, not on flips or wholesale deals.
Because that's your business. You're a real estate professional. You're not a capital gain would be more of like, so this is an example that would probably drive that point home. Let's say there's an old guy, he's 70 years old. He's selling his one rental property he's had for 50 years. It's free and clear.
Yep.
Now that would be a capital gain versus an ordinary income, correct? Because he's really not like a guy flipping properties. Exactly. Okay. Exactly.
And look at it this way, right? So let's say you and I have some Apple stock, right?
Yeah.
And we sell the Apple stock. It went up $10 a share. There's our capital gain, right?
Yeah.
That's definitely capital gains because it's not our business. But there are some people where they're in the business of day trading, stuff like that. So for them, it would be ordinary income.
Ordinary income. And that's a big point to know, because a lot of people, they get confused when it comes to this. And I always say, like, you know, if you do $1 million in revenue and you have $800,000 in expenses, your ordinary income is only going to be $200,000. You're not paying capital gains, like, you know, and that's where people get kind of confused. And I'm like, no, like, you're going to pay a lot less taxes than you probably think, because you do have those expenses associated with.
Yeah, that's why it's very important to talk to a professional instead of trying to do this yourself.
Oh, 100%.
First of all, doing your own taxes takes up a lot of time. Second of all, there's a 0% chance that you know as much about tax law as I do.
Yes, yes, right? 100%.
Not just you, everybody. Everybody that's not in the tax world, there's a 0% chance that you and Devin and Larry and anybody else that is a some of you guys, I teach some of you guys some stuff sometimes, but it's not what you do.
Yes, it's not our niche.
Vice versa, I don't flip houses. So if I wanted to do a deal like that, I'd come to one of you guys with a check and say, here, take my check and let's make some money.
Yeah, right? Yeah, yeah. Versus trying to like go out and, you know, find, yeah, no. And that's the stay in your lane, right? Like, I need to know a little bit about taxes, but you're the expert, right? Like, and that's where I see a lot of people. They're like, oh, I'm going to save money by doing my taxes. And I'm like, you're going to spend a lot more money and have a lot more time and be a lot more stressed out. And you're going to be like, you know, a mess.
Yeah. Yeah. This is what Leo and I, and you remember Jeremiah's came on once or twice.
Yeah.
This is what we do. This is what we focus on. Right.
Totally.
Our fees aren't always cheap, right? But that's okay. You're getting a lot of value for what we do when we come. Just like if I come to you with a check, you're going to be taking a cut of the deal, of course.
Yeah.
But I'm getting value out of what you're doing. So I'm happy for you to take some money out because I want you to make money and be happy to do a deal with me if we're doing a deal.
Exactly. It's got to be a win-win for everyone around, which is the key. So here's another point I want to cover while we have you on the show. And this is something that I started doing last year, is buying rental properties and doing that to obviously have some assets, but as well as, you know, mitigate my tax liability. So can you just kind of share what a cost segregation is and how the cost segregation can really get someone who's making a lot of money to sometimes get money back from the government because of the cost segregation. And then the cost segregation is a little more advanced. So I definitely want you to like drill it home, because when people understand this, they can make a lot of money tax-free because of the way the system is set up.
Cost segregation is one of the two most powerful tools in real estate, and maybe all of business, right? So if you're in real estate owning rentals, you have to be a real estate professional to get a benefit from this, right? So if you're an accountant and you have one or two rentals, it's not likely that a cost segregation study is really going to benefit you.
Yeah.
Right. It's more of the real estate professionals where you can benefit from the tax losses of the property while you're still cash flowing on that six unit that's paying the bills, you're getting a bunch of cash, but all of a sudden on your tax return, you're in the negative, right? So a cost segregation study allows you to take your rental property and basically pull it apart in different asset classes, and some of it will get depreciated quicker, right? So if you have a home where people are living, right? And normally that's 27 and a half years that you're depreciating the house.
Yes.
Right? If you're not doing the cost seg study, right? 39 for commercial, 27 and a half for residential for the most part, right? So you're like, okay, you're chugging along, taking that little bit each year. And then all of a sudden you hear about a cost segregation study. And most of those guys are accountants that are pulling apart the different assets, right? They have like all tables and everything that they go through. I don't do them. I send them out because there's guys that specialize in doing them, right? And all of a sudden, of that $200,000 three unit you just bought in Monroe or wherever it is, right?
Yeah.
You might be able to take a third of that quicker than that 27 and a half years. Now I'm just throwing out a number. It might not be exactly a third, but it's a good chunk. It might be a little more, a little less, but you're taking a good chunk of that sooner and maybe right away. It might become an asset that you can take what we call section 179 depreciation, which means you're getting it right away.
Interesting.
So you might be getting cash flow, and then the rest you're taking over the 27 and a half years.
Yeah.
So it's really, as you can imagine, it's really most powerful when you're buying the bigger properties. The more you're buying the property for, the more of this you can get.
Interesting. So you can really minimize your tax liability by doing this.
And maybe to zero. Listen, everybody, and I don't care if you like him or hate him. I don't care about that. But that's how Trump pays little to no taxes. That's one of the ways.
Because he's cost-segging like a hotel, you know?
Yeah, and he has tons of properties. He's a real estate guy, right?
Interesting. Yeah, and that's why a lot of people are like, well, the rich don't pay their fair share in taxes.
No, they do. But,
well, yeah, they say that. They say that claim.
Yeah.
But if you really look at the actual liability they might have if you follow the rules by doing a cost seg, legally they don't have to pay the taxes because they're depreciating it. And then, yeah, if they make $10 million, they're going to pay more in taxes than the average guy anyway, you know, which they don't tell you, you know? Yeah.
And there's so many other things out there where they're paying.
Yes.
So many different things. And you have to remember that they're not going to voluntarily pay more in taxes, right? If you really want them to pay more in taxes, the laws have to change, not the person.
Exactly. The system. Right? Exactly. And the system is designed for real estate ownership because real estate ownership provides housing, which is a basic human need. So it's not like they're like paying no taxes for no reason. If you own 100 rental properties, you're housing 100, if not more, people. And that is an incentive by the government because they need that housing. And government is housing is generally a private practice. It's not like you're just going to live for free. You know, there's some programs and stuff like that. But that Section 8, that obviously helps the investor out, you know.
And to tell you the truth, the true public housing, like the NYCHA in the city, right? Landlords, for the most part, unless they're slumlords, which NYCHA might be.
Yeah.
The government's not properly keeping up with rehabbing their rentals and fixing things.
No, right? They're not.
The people that, and this is nothing against the people living there, right? So please, anybody listening, don't take this the wrong way. It's not against the people living in the housing. It's against the people who are not taking care of the housing that they're living in, right?
Yes.
It's not always good conditions, right?
No.
They're not taking care. We always hear on the news every year that NYCHA isn't fixing heat. NYCHA isn't fixing hot water. And it's the middle of the winter and they're not fixing the heat. And you see people put in dangerous situations where they're having to get heat from their stove or they don't have heat at all. And you see some elderly people or little kids
freezing.
And it's terrible.
Yeah. But the thing with that,
you want to incentivize private investors to come in and do the right thing.
Exactly. And that's why it's like at the end of the day, the more you know the rules by listening to this stuff and hiring experts like Andrew, the better you're going to be versus having to try to figure it all out on your own, you know. And there's so many ways to understand the tax game. And Andrew's been an expert for years and years and years doing this. And that's why it's always beneficial to align with experts versus trying to do it all on your own, you know.
You really have to, right? So you're not going to go into one of your flips and try to change the HVAC system,
no,
right?
Never.
Don't do your own taxes either.
Exactly. Don't do your own taxes. It's funny that just to kind of wrap everything up, like I remember I was reluctant to do the whole self-employment tax thing. And I said, you know what? I'm going to just do this S Corp thing. And it has been a game changer for me and for Devin and for a lot of other guys who are doing the business full time. They're saving a lot of money, you know.
You have to do it the right way.
Oh yeah, of course.
You have to pay yourself the reasonable salary. Right. So you're not getting off totally scot-free.
Yeah.
You have to do it the right way. You have to run your business the right way, which is part of where we come into play. Right. But there really are legitimate tax saving strategies out there where you can really save some money. Right. There's the 1031 exchanges, which are under a little fire now. There's the cost seg studies. There's the qualified opportunity zones. There's self-directed IRAs and 401ks, which I have a self-directed 401k right now myself. And I have it in a rental. I have a couple private money loans. I have a couple little startup situations. So there's so many tools out there. And those are just a few. Those are just a few
totally.
Of the dozens and dozens of tools that you
totally have. 100%. And one more thing to mention as we wrap the show up is an actionable item for the investor listening to this, or any entrepreneur listening to this, or anyone who wants to be an investor and entrepreneur, is you got to always stay on top of your books too. And that's another thing. People will, they'll just let their checking accounts and their credit card bills arrear and they won't like account for them. But if you can just get into the discipline of staying on top of your books and making sure that you have the things itemized and accounted for, it's going to make your accountant, whether it's Andrew or Knott's life, so much easier, because they can go in and they can already see the big picture and they can make little adjustments versus just giving them a bank statement and an Amex statement and saying, here, this is from the whole year, figure it out. That's not the way to go, because that makes everyone's life a lot harder. Would you agree?
Yeah, definitely. So first of all, it'll declutter your mind if you're in order, right? 1,000,000%. Second of all, we have so many more tools if you use our expertise throughout the year than if you come to us in January and say, here's my bank statements for the prior year.
That's right? Crazy.
Did you know that a 1031 exchange, you could only do for a certain amount of time after you sell the original property, right? You don't have until you come talk to me in February.
No, you only have like 60 days or something like more than something.
You have to find a new property within 45 days and you have to close within 180 and you have to use a qualified intermediary, right? So there's rules. You have to follow them. And look, some people who don't follow the rules don't get caught and they get lucky. But I'm not here to try to get lucky. I'm here to properly advise you how to run your business tax efficiently so that you can pay less in taxes, be structured properly, hopefully protect your assets. I'm not an attorney, but I have a lot of general gist of what you should be doing. But you should also be talking to an attorney to properly structure your deals and your business.
100%.
It's very important stuff. Very
100%. Important. Well, Andrew, man, it's always a blast talking to you and getting you on the show.
Yeah, I love coming on.
For sure, man. So if people were interested in inquiring about how you might be able to help them, what is the best way for them? We'll give them a website and then a social media profile. And then I'll have my assistant put this in the show notes.
Yep. So you could find me on Facebook, right? I'm all over posting on Facebook, just like you are. I'm doing different little tidbits once in a while. So you could, Andrew Kabatchnick, you could find me on Facebook. My website is www.andrew-cpa.com. Easy to remember. So you could always, my number's up there, my email's up there. You could ping me on social media. I don't generally have full-on tax strategy conversations on social media, but at least you'll reach out to me and we'll find a quick few minutes to hop on the phone or email or something like that.
Perfect. I'll make sure all that's in the show notes. And man, this has been a blast.
Yeah.
We're always sharing the knowledge and I appreciate you hopping on the show today, man. Thanks so much.
All right. Thanks a lot for having me.
Thanks for listening to another episode of Pave the Way Podcast. We hope you got value from today's episode. Make sure you download Greg's free guide on daily personal productivity for free at www.pavetheday.com. That's Pave the Day, spelled D-A-Y.com. If you have any questions or want to reach out, head over to www.pavethewaypodcast.com. We'll see you on the next episode.